Welcome to Creation Magazine Live. We're looking at articles from past issues of Creation Magazine. What do we have now?
Well, hopefully if people like what they hear, they'll maybe think about getting a subscription to Creation Magazine.
Hey, there's an idea.
Yeah. And one of the reasons why we're doing this is to give people an idea of what the magazine colors, the full scope of it. I think sometimes people say, well, what are they going to talk about? And is it really going to be faith building? Or
is it going to be all science-y stuff?
That's right.
Things like that. But no, there's theology, there's Christian living, and of course, looking in depth at that question, where have we come from? Right. And is the Bible true? Can the Genesis account be trusted?
Right. Now, this is from one of the editorials by Dr. Jonathan Sarfati, and interesting title, Loving the Bible to Death. Now, you'd think, well, how could a Christian do that? I mean, we love God, we love His Word, and you know, the two are interconnected, obviously. So, but anyway, let's look at what he says and unpack this a little bit. That atheists loathe creation ministries should surprise no one. As Oxford evolutionist and anti-theist Richard Dawkins claims, it was impossible to be an intellectually fulfilled atheist before Darwin. And since Darwin's theory was proposed to allegedly explain life without God, undermining Darwin would undermine the atheist's faith. So it is mystifying that many conservative Christian colleges and seminaries also seem to loathe creationists. But for those among them that are genuinely conservative rather than liberals in conservative clothing, the answer may come from a well-meaning love for the Bible, trying to protect it from being falsified by science that ends up undermining it. Now this is actually true. There are you know, Christian organizations, there are Christian I guess you say denominations. I mean, you can't say everyone in that denomination, but there are certain pockets of Christianity that are kind of, they just don't want to have anything to do with creationism. They've accepted evolution as fact, or, you know, for whatever reason. But many of them haven't really accepted it as fact, but they say, well, it's a controversial issue, so let's just not talk about it.
Don't rock the boat. We might lose people.
Right.
And there's that kind of a...
But I think what he's pointing out is it's almost like an underlying fear that perhaps, like he said, we want to protect the Bible from being falsified by science, right? So anyway, he goes on and he's talking about understanding Genesis. As our interview with Hebrew scholar Dr. Ting Wang shows, that interview, by the way, is in this edition of Creation Magazine, which is the September edition from 2005, volume 27, number 4. So you can check out the interview with Dr. Wang. He shows that the Hebrew of Genesis is clear about creation in 6 consecutive normal length days, a global flood, and that death and suffering came in with Adam's sin. This was also the overwhelming view of the church fathers and reformers. And Dr. Sarfati has written a book called Refuting Compromise, where he goes over that in detail, showing that that was the mainstream view of Christianity for hundreds of years.
And that book has been called a creation classic, an instant creation classic,
right,
by some of the leaders in the creation
That's
movement.
Right. No matter which way you're looking at this, you're trying to figure out Genesis, that would be a book, if you want to know what the young earth creationist position is, or the biblical creationist, that's a book you should get, at least to know what the position is.
Absolutely,
Anyway, but around 1800, anti-Christians began teaching that the world was much older than the Bible taught, and the church responded in various ways. A number of theological liberals, wolves in sheep's clothing, were only too happy to accept this fledgling new science. But they fully agreed with their forebears and today's liberals about what the Bible intended to say. So a lot of them went along with the long age theory, but they did agree. No. Well, if you want to know what the Bible writers intended to say, they said that the Bible's clear statements had been disproven by scientists. So the liberals said, Genesis actually means what it means, but it's not true.
It's wrong.
Right.
Yeah.
But the conservatives loved the Bible and rightly believed that it was completely accurate. However, many were intimidated by the new long age science and invented ways of reinterpreting what the Bible says to allegedly harmonize the Bible with science. This was the origin of the ideas such as the day-age notion, the gap theory, the framework hypothesis, and theistic evolution. Others called the scripture geologists refused to pretzelize, I like that term he uses, the Bible, and challenged the assumptions of long-age geology. But most in the church found it easier to appease the long-age anti-Christians, so the scriptural geologists were largely ignored, although not refuted. So he's pointing out, here's a case where, no, people legitimate, you know, God-loving, you know, Christians just said, well, maybe we can figure out ways to make Genesis not mean what it plainly says.
Yes, and that
way we'll protect it. We can say, no, we're legitimate, we believe in science, et cetera, because science is becoming equated with evolution. But
right.
evolution's more of a philosophy. It's a way of looking at the evidence, not just facts. Anyway, consequence of appeasement. Far from such appeasement on Genesis history, protecting the credibility of the Bible, the reverse happened. The whole Bible, with its faith and morality, came under attack. And these critics are being consistent. If the first book of the Bible needs to be twisted to fit science, why not everything else? As Jesus told Nicodemus in John 3:12, I've spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? If Jesus was wrong about the earthly things, such as a recent creation, which he talks about in Mark 10:6-9, and a global flood, which he mentions in Luke 17:26-27, was he also wrong about the heavenly things, like John 3:16, only four verses later? And if not, why not? That's a question I've gone into when I'm talking to people who have accepted millions of years in evolution. I say, well, how do you know then? You know this, you don't need to reinterpret. How do you then know about this area?
And it's a good question.
I used to hit Christians with that when I was a non-Christian, when I was a skeptic.
Really?
Yeah, because they'd talk to me about the Bible and I'd say, wait a sec, you believe some story about some guy who got two of every animal on a boat? And they'd go, well, that could be just And I'd be like, well, then this part over here about the dead guy coming back to life? Yeah, it's probably just a story too.
Yeah.
And they couldn't, what were they going to say then? Oh, yeah. you got to believe this part. Why? Right?
I mean, it's the Word of God. You're not supposed to, no one is supposed to modify it in any way by addition or subtraction.
That's right.
If it's all the Word of God, it starts with Genesis 1:1. Genesis is a part of the Word of God.
And Jesus believed Genesis.
People are being consistent, right?
Right.
If it's not right in Genesis, then it doesn't necessarily mean that it's right in the New Testament.
That's right. So you need to be rational and logical and consistent when you're giving an argument. Right?
Sure. Yeah.
It's no accident that churches and institutions which start rejecting Genesis history generally move on to rejecting other vital doctrines. Many churches that started by rejecting biblical authority in science areas now have ministers who actually reject the resurrection and virginal conception of Christ. After all, science says that dead men don't rise and virgins don't conceive. Here's something that the atheists, I see in their literature all the time. You know, they point to theistic evolutionists and they mock them and they say, well, yeah, they obviously know that everything just evolved. But meanwhile, they're still Christians because they believe that virgins give birth and dead people come back to life. They must be crazy.
Yes.
How are they compartmentalizing their brain, et cetera, et cetera?
That's a problem when you try to combine evolution and God.
That's right. So reclaiming the ground. Creation Magazine seeks to recover biblical authority in a number of ways. The first is to show the importance of Genesis creation, as shown on page 43. Another article, creation is not in the same category as end times debates and other disputes such as baptism, the Sabbath, or church governances. While important, these debates presuppose biblical authority and disagree only on its meaning. But the creation issue is about whether the Bible or science is the authority.
Good point.
Great point.
Yes.
If you've got a group of pastors sitting around arguing about doctrinal differences, they're all going to point to certain passages in Scripture.
They should be,
to back up their beliefs. But when you've got a Christian saying, yeah, but my geology professor, the earth is millions of years old, they're actually going outside of it to
And because of what they're saying, I'm not going to believe the Bible.
Exactly. I'm not going to take it as plainly written.
Right.
So that's extra biblical interpretation.
It's a different argument than some of these other things that Dr. Sarfati has mentioned.
So I think this is a great way that Dr. Sarfati has outlined this. So I encourage you to check out the article.
Great.